Network address translation, what is it? What does it work? And how have you used it every single day that you've gotten on the internet your whole life without ever realizing it and without your computer even realizing it? What it is mapping an IP address, one IP address on the outside to a different IP address on the inside. Most often that's going to be a public IP address on the outside to the private IP address on the inside of a network. Doesn't have to be that way. It can be public to public, but most often it is used public to private. You have used it if you have used AWS, if you have set up an EC2 instance, almost definitely you have used network address translation, again, without even knowing it. You have set up a public IP address. So up here we have a public IP address for a server that is 54.191.159.95 and a private IP address that is 172.31.26.155. Well, guess what? Your computer, your EC2 instance only knows about this private IP address. In fact, I logged into my server to get it, and look, right there is our private IP address. That is the computer, that is the IP address that this computer thinks that it has. This is an EC2 instance, that's the IP address that it has. So as far as this computer is concerned, it has that IP address. But Amazon says, okay, I'm also gonna give you that public IP address. And if somebody goes to that public IP address on the outside of the network, I know where to send it on the inside of the network, and that is 172.31.26.155. So on the inside of the network, our computer is seeing this traffic that was originally sent to 54.191.159.195. And that is exactly what network address translation is. It's taking one IP address on the outside to a different IP address on the inside. Now, why would we do it? It does a bunch of things for us. One of the things that it does, it hides internal IP addressing information. So inside of our network, I've got that 172.31 address. Well, guess what? Nobody outside of the network needs to know that. Nobody on the internet needs to know that inside, I mean, now you know, but nobody else outside of my network needs to know that on the inside I am 172.31.whatever I am, because that's private information, so I can keep that internal structure of my network, the way that things connect inside of my network, a secret from the outside, and only provide access from the outside through that public address. If everything on the had a public address and was only accessible from that public address, then all of my network information is accessible and visible and knowable by those outside from things like port scans and all of those things. So we can hide information, and it allows faster changing of IP addresses. Amazon uses it all the time, because when you shut down an instance, it takes away that public IP address, allocates it to somebody else so that, that somebody else can use that IP address while you're not using it, unless you pay for an elastic IP. But it allows that switch to happen instantly, and you can pretty much instantly switch the IP address, the public IP address, while keeping the internal private IP address exactly the same. So those are some benefits there. So I want you to look. I want you to look right now. Pause the video if you need to. Look at what IP address your computer thinks it has. If you're on Windows, open up a command prompt, type ipconfig. If you're on a Mac, open up a command prompt or a terminal and type ipconfig get ifadder EN0 if you're on Wi-Fi. If you're on a different network, you'll have to figure out how to do that. But if you're on Wi-Fi, it's going to be this command right here. So if you're on Windows, this is what it's going to look like. You're going to see a bunch of things that look like this. What you're going to look for here is the interface name that's associated with the interface that you are using. If you're on Wi-Fi, it's going to say something about Wi-Fi there. If you're on Ethernet, it's going to be something about Ethernet. It might say something about Ethernet if you're on Wi-Fi, because Wi-Fi is often called wireless Ethernet. So take a look there, find the interface name associated with your network, and then you can look down here and find IPv4 address, and here mine is 10.211.55.3. So that is my private address for this network. Yours will be something different, probably, but look for whichever one is associated with the way that you are connecting to the internet, whether it's wireless or wired. If you're on a Mac, if you're on wireless, this is the really easy command, because all it gives you back is the IP address. So it says ipconfig get ifadder, that's get interface address. EN0 is the interface that we're looking for here, and here it gives us the IPv4 address underneath. In this case, 192.168.1.12. So this is my private address on my Mac laptop. That's great. That's your private address. But as we have learned about public and private IP addresses, private IP addresses cannot be used on the internet. So what IP address does Google think that you have? Because it can't be that private address, because private IP addresses can't be on the internet. So if you go to Google and search what is my IP address, you will get something like this. And it provides that information to me right here. And look, I am 128.187.112.28, which is different from the IP address that my computer thinks it has. My computer has one address, Google thinks it has another address. And network address translation is the way that that works. So let's take a look. We've talked about private addresses. They can't be used on the internet. They're awesome for internal networks. And so through network address translation, also known as NAT overloading, also known as port address translation, they are still able to access the internet, but using a public address, borrowing a public address from somewhere else. And what does that look like? It looks like this. So this is an example of an internal network. Here we have a router. Here we have a few devices on that internal network with various IP addresses. And those are all in that private range, the 192.168 private range. So those are all private addresses. This is the inside of a network. This is not connected to anything yet. We're about to. Let's connect it to the internet. So we're going to connect this router to the internet. And this router is from your ISP or wherever you get your IP addresses from, probably your internet service provider. It's given an address of 85.22.223.9. That is a public address. It's in the public range. So that is the address that your router is going to use to communicate with the internet. But it wouldn't do you much good if your router was the only device that could talk to the internet, because your router isn't that cool. I would like to be able to play video games. I would like to be able to browse the internet. I would like to be able to do all the things. So how are we going to get these private addresses onto this outside address and onto other things? Let's look at what would happen if we connected to google.com. This is an IP address for www.google.com, 172.217.0.8. So what's going to happen when we try to go to www.google.com? Let's simplify this network a little bit. We'll pull it down to just one device on the network, one device with a private IP of 192.168.1.7, the router with its IP address, and the external IP address. So the router has two IP addresses because it has to have an address for every network that it's connected to. And then through the internet, we're connecting to google.com. What does that look like? Well, first, the first thing that's going to happen is my computer, when I go to google.com, it's going to make a packet that's destined for Google. So the information on that, TCP, destination port 80. We're pretending HTTPS doesn't exist yet. Probably not a good assumption, but we're going to assume it anyway. So we are going to destination port 80. We're going to pick a source port from that dynamic range, let's say 50,123, just something that we're going to use, but we're going to use that throughout this example here. And then we're going to set our destination IP address of 172.217.0.68, which is our Google IP address, and our source IP address of that packet of us, 192.168.1.7. Remember though, that's our private address. But where does that have to go to get outside of our network? Because the destination is outside of our network, that's going to go to our router. And that's going to arrive at the router. The router is going to look at the packet and say, hold on a second, that private address cannot be used outside of the network, so I am going to replace it. So the router is going to receive that packet, and it's going to replace the private IP address with a brand new public IP address and a new port. And that's going to be important. I'll explain why in just a minute, so hang tight. So TCP, destination port 80, that doesn't change, because we still want to go to Google on port 80. We still want to send HTTP traffic, so that's got to stay the same. But we have a new source port. We have a new source port. Remember, it was 50,123 before. Now the source port is 60,987. So the router has selected a new source port for traffic coming back, and it has replaced the source IP address. The destination stays the same. We're still going to Google, but has replaced the source IP address with its own address so that traffic comes back to a public address, because on the internet, everything has to have a public address to be able to work. And then what the router does is it makes a little note. The router remembers that return traffic for port 60,987, which is the one that it replaced it with, goes to 192.168.1.7 on port 50,123. So we have replaced that port, but then we have to remember, the router has to remember that when stuff comes back on that new port that I replaced it with, I need to send it to the place that my computer, the computer, thinks that traffic is going to be coming from. This is an example of what some pseudocode might look like. So it's going to check the destination port on traffic coming back and the source IP address of traffic coming back. So is it coming back from Google on the port that we sent to Google on? And if so, then we're going to forward that traffic to the internal address of the computer and the internal port that the computer was using. And then when the router receives a return packet from Google. So we've got that packet sent. We've stored the information in the router's memory so it knows where things are going to be coming from when they come back. So when the router receives the return packet, it's going to look at the information. And on the way back, that information is going to be TCP destination 60,987 because that's the packet the router sent out. Source is port 80 because that hasn't changed. And the destination is going to be the interface of the router, and the source is going to be the IP address of google.com. So we have Google sending back information to the router. And as far as Google is concerned, it's talking with the router. And what the router is going to do is it's going to replace that destination info. So when it reads the packet off the network, it's going to take that information, it's going to manipulate the things that it manipulates before it sends it on. And the things that it needs to change are that destination port needs to go back to the port that the computer on the inside was expecting. So the computer on the inside was 50,123. The computer on the inside is 192.168.1.7. So that information is forwarded on. The entire packet is, well, the destination part of the packet is rewritten. The rest of it stays the same. The packet is forwarded on. And everybody's happy. And the computer on the inside and Google on the outside have no idea that this happened, and they don't care because they are able to communicate in the way that they want. And the only one that knows that this is happening is the router right up there, way up there in the corner. And that is doing the translation, handling all of this. And the router is handling this dozens, hundreds, thousands of times per minute per second to communicate every single packet that comes in and out of the network is getting that information swapped before the packet is sent both ways, on the inside and on the outside, or going in and going out. That information needs to be replaced to make the network function because the private IP addresses work on the inside, they don't work on the outside, and on the inside, the computers only know about their private address, so to get information back, that information has to be replaced. So if we look at this, what if we make the network a little bit more complicated? What if we add another computer? Really simple example. So we're gonna have the same kind of thing going on. So as this packet, this is the entry in the address translation table that the router has in its memory. And it's just going to remember that google.com, remember, on the inside was 50,123, on the outside is 60,987. And as traffic comes and goes, it's doing that translation. If my other computer also wants to go to google.com, we've got our other inside host, another inside port, another outside port, and the same outside host. So as information comes and goes, it's tracking that information. So we've got both of these able to communicate just fine, and this is happening. This table is hundreds of records long as each website that you go to and each domain or each IP address that you visit and each service that you use keeps track of different ports. Now, what if by some chance, both of these choose the same inside port? What if, for example, the inside port was 50,123, that we already have for this one, and this second computer chooses the same inside port? What's gonna happen then? Nothing. It's gonna work just fine because our inside port stays the same, our outside port changes. That's why the router changes the port with that traffic so that it doesn't matter what port was used on the inside. We can have a separate port that's independent of that on the outside, and so we have 50,123 on the inside. On the outside, for example, 60,258. Going to a different computer on the outside, and as traffic comes and goes, the ports get translated in both directions as things are coming and going. So it doesn't matter what port the inside computers use, it doesn't matter if they duplicate themselves, the port address translation takes care of all of that for us, which is awesome. So finally, I want you to check yourself. I want you to explain to yourself, what information does the router use to do NAT, and specifically the NAT overloading or port address translation that we talked about that allows one public IP address to go to multiple private IP addresses on the inside of the network? And then more generally, can you explain to yourself how a computer can have a private IP address and still access the internet? What has to happen to allow private IP addresses to be able to use the internet? And if you can do that, I'd say you have a pretty good handle on how network address translation works.